is CGTN, China Global Television Network.
Food security makes headlines. With less than 9% of the world's arable land, China feeds 22% of the world's population.
作为中国的一个科技探索者, 我希望把人工智能和第一产业相结合。
Loess Plateau, this once barren land, is becoming fertile farmland. How do the local villagers do this? In this special episode of Closer to China, we examine China's agriculture sector. What's the plan to ensure food security and to raise farmers' standard of living? For the past 20 years, the first policy statement released each year by the CPC Central Committee and the State Council, central document number one, is always on China's rural areas and agriculture, assuring food safety for the country and improving the standard of living for farmers. In 2023, document number one focused on rural vitalization and accelerating the modernization process in rural regions with emphasis on food security. The document outlines 9 tasks and 33 primary points. These include constructing a strong agriculture sector, enhancing food security, extending poverty alleviation, building business-friendly and beautiful villages, protecting cultivated land, preventing heavy metal pollution, providing ecological compensation, and piloting green agriculture and renewable energy in rural areas. The document calls for improving the rural living environment with programs for clean villages, installing sewage treatment, and utilizing organic waste. We focus on 2 case studies that exemplify the big vision of rural vitalization and self-sufficient modernization, food security, and arable land reclamation to be closer to China. Everybody loves to eat. And the Chinese are the masters at eating. Human beings stopped being hunter-gatherers thousands of years ago when they learned to harness the power of seeds. They were now able to grow, store, and save all those seeds so they still had enough food during all seasons. The trade of surplus food formed the basis of what we call an agrarian economy. The common enemies of seed plants were pests, frost, floods, deserts, and other unfavorable conditions, including unsuitable soil.
Driven by persistent conflicts, pre-existing and COVID-19-related economic shocks, and also weather extremes, more than 345 million people are now facing a high level of food insecurity, according to the World Food Program analysis. An increase of almost 200 million since early 2020. Over this, 43 million are just one step away from the famine.
The hundreds of millions of hungry people on our planet attest to the need to address these problems. China harnesses the power of science to produce better yields. A sizable portion of the national research budget is allocated to advanced science and technology in search of better crops.
When people think of corn, actually people really think about the sweet corn, waxy corn, and popcorn. But actually corn has much more usage than that. The number one usage is animal feed. In China, that percentage is approximately 70%. And the second usage is industrial raw materials, such as industrial beverages, such as sodas, you know, is a raw material for that.
Other uses of corn include liquor production, seasonings, pharmaceuticals, and as bioenergy fuel.
The color, size, texture, nutrition, yield, and so on, they are all determined by the DNA code of the seed. By identifying and understanding how each DNA code works, scientists today are able to select better and better seeds. In the past, it was all through trials and errors, requiring enormous amount of time, energy, and resources. Every corn breeder is dreaming of a super corn. It has to meet the following three general standards. The first one, it has to produce more grains than the average corn varieties. Second, it has to be resistant to the different diseases and to the different insects or pests. The third one, it performs well in the bad weathers, such as a strong wind, dry land, or wet land. In order to develop better seed, we need to understand its genome. Just like a patient goes to see a doctor in a hospital, so a doctor asks him or her to do an MRI or X-ray test so that the doctor have a good understanding of this patient. With this DNA analysis, we have a better and deeper understanding of a seed.
This understanding of good breeds is applicable for every food we eat. Better breeds means better yields, better flavor, all the good stuff.
Plant genome can be very complicated. Wheat, for example, has a very large and complex genome. Its genome size is 16 gigabytes, which is about 5 times of human genome size. If we assume one base of nucleotide is 1 millimeter long, the wheat genome would be 160,000 kilometers long. That would make 8 times the length of the Great Wall.
Now, even if we have the best seed that can deliver the best of every trait we desire, we still need sufficient and suitable land on which to grow it. China's total landmass is similar to that of the U.S., but around 1/5 of China is covered by glaciers, snow, and deserts.
China has given high regards to food security as a top priority for state governance and national stability through rural reform and innovative and agriculture development initiatives, as well as poverty alleviation and rural revitalization programs.
This village used to do monocrop cultivation before we arrived. The only crop they planted was radishes.
Today they are planting tomatoes, corn, peanuts, and chrysanthemum in addition to radishes.
In 2009, China Agricultural University started its first science and technology backyard. Under this program, over 1,000 teams are assigned to do field work for 18 months in various villages all around the country.
Here we carry out R&D and introduce technological innovation at the ground level. No pun intended.
We work hand in hand with farmers, government officials, and companies. The end result, rural revitalization.
In 2020, the village income was around 110,000 yuan. In 3 years, it has increased to over 700,000 yuan.
As a direct result of the increase in income, these villagers now enjoy tangible benefits from a better quality of life, including new roads, playgrounds, and so on.
As household incomes increase, the types and variants of food people choose to eat start to differ. For example, Chinese people start to import exotic variants of rice, such as the Thai home mali, the Indian basmati rice, and so on.
Well, the national strategy for food security and features self-sufficiency based on domestic grain production, guaranteeing the food production capacity, and the moderate inputs, and the grain reserve and technological support.
As a result, the decisions of planting single crop versus double crop are based on the taste of the rice, not on food sufficiency as it was decades ago.
As a science and technology explorer, I hope to use AI to improve the efficiency of China's agriculture. Compared with the traditional manual operation, this GPS-enabled transplanter will cover an area of 6 to 7 hectares per day for transplanting rice seedlings. This will better control the row spacing, plant spacing, and depth of transplanting. if we use manual labor. It would only be around 0.06 hectares per day. This machine can do the work of around 80 to 100 people.
In 2020, grain output in China hit a record high of 670 million tons despite the pandemic. Grain output per capita increased to 478 kilograms, well exceeding the international basic food safety line of 400 kilograms per capita.
This tractor looks very ordinary, but is actually a fully automated GPS-based machine. It will increase efficiency by about 40 to 50% compared to normal tractors. Its operation accuracy is far better than what any human can do.
Data from the Ministry of Agriculture and Rural Affairs showed that the comprehensive mechanization level of crop cultivation, planting, and harvesting grew from 57% in 2012 to over 72% in 2021.
With this high-tech central control system, an administrator can manage more than 400 acres of land, even while on vacation.
Be it rural traditional markets in villages or mega markets in large mega cities, what you will find in China is exactly the same.
This is a very typical grocery store found all over the country. Come and follow me. I will show you what's inside.
Here's some food for thought. The price of stable grains remained almost unchanged over the past 10 years.
As a result of government's strong promotion of agriculture production, we have abundant of food supply. As you can see, we have so many different varieties of choices for people to choose.
China has ample stockpiles of grains. Its national reserves of wheat, rice, and corn can support domestic consumption for up to 13 months, far higher than the generally accepted international level of 3 to 6 months' supply for food security. That's why the Chinese government says that for food security, there's no better place than in China.
President Xi Jinping has recently re-emphasized food security, domestic self-sufficiency in food production, as a top priority in governance and among the highest of national security matters. Chinese leaders have always been concerned about food security. Former paramount leader Deng Xiaoping said, China should avoid relying on imports to meet its food demand. Then former President Jiang Zemin said feeding China's vast population kept him up at night. President Xi's focus on food security is motivated by volatile contemporary conditions, increasing geopolitical tensions that could spring sanctions, global supply chain interruptions by uncontrollable events like pandemics, and sudden shocks like global grain shortages triggered by Russia's war against Ukraine. China is directly dependent on the U.S. for soy and corn. China's domestic production of soybeans is less than 20% of its consumption needs. Imports of soybeans, well over 90 million tons a year, account for 60% of the world's traded soybeans. Xi's new food security concept is basically self-sufficiency in grains and absolute food security, setting a national food security strategy of putting ourselves first and ensuring production capacity, moderate imports, and scientific and technological support. She said, food security is the most important thing in a country. And he calls for protecting and improving the quality of agricultural land, expanding agricultural production areas and capacity. More farmland will mean more grain production and less reliance on imported grain, she said. The rice bowls of the Chinese people must be firmly in our own hands. Our rice bowls should be filled mainly by Chinese crops.
Each day, there are millions of stories. Each one can open new perspectives, new possibilities. Wherever you look, we are there. To see, discover, explore,
we put the pieces together to find what really matters to you. All around the world, all around the clock. Our reporters are at home across the globe. From our headquarters in Beijing and production centers in Washington, Nairobi, and London, China Global Television Network. Stories from across the globe, reaching people across the globe. CGTN. See the difference.
With some 70% of the Earth's Loess, China's Loess Plateau is the largest in the world. But erosion has removed precious sand deposits, forming a plethora of gullies. After decades of revegetation, greenery began to spread. Gaoxigo village, located at the heart of this plateau, is a perfect example. Villagers have planted crops for generations, but apple planting is something new. An apple tree takes 2 to 3 years to grow before it bears fruit. It's difficult to tend to the trees, and it takes a long time for the fruits to grow. Whether they can bring profits or even just survive remains uncertain. When Gaoxigo village took on the challenge of planting apples in 2006, villagers watched hesitantly. Located in the heartland of the Loess Plateau, numerous gullies run through Gaoxigo village and arable land is scarce. Throughout history, to obtain valuable farmland necessary for survival, locals continuously cleared and cultivated hillsides to plant crops like millet and sustain their most basic needs.
广州博士农民好苦，这一主要就是一头流失业状，一到暴雨期间就路断人行，山上也没法上，路闯回来，沟里了沟道不走出去。To
conserve water and soil, villagers in Gaoxigo began constructing terraced fields on a large scale and built silt dams in the gullies in the 1950s. However, heavy rain washed away the terraced fields, dams, and slopes that already lacked vegetation cover.
This is 60年代栽的油苗，当时栽的时候是摇摇带苗，高度是20公分，完了浇上水，这是几十年才形成这个苗子。 我叫叶如鹏，是1988年从陕西省良校毕业。 也就从事山地造林和水土保持造林工作。今年56岁，工作已干了35年了。大家看到这个，这都是树枯子落叶，形成的腐殖之层，下边都是黑的。你看现在挖开以后，有这个腐殖之覆盖的都是石头，就是山梁只有保持水源的作用。你看这个边边的，这都是礁石。有这种的地方的话，容易生根，栽树呀，成活高。
These pine trees were among the first batch of ecological forests for soil and water conservation planted by the villagers in Gaoxigo.
Now we can see that Gaoxigo is a lot of trees, but the trees that are in the trees, 90% of them are all burned by the fire. The first thing is to do.当时就是老百姓背上挎包，拿上个小镢头，自儿装那个，爬到山上。过去还有着我们发明的这绳子拉到那种红细细那个，是吊到悬崖边脚上套中间去。它一有雨水的自然就行了。等个阴阳雨天，降雨了，它慢慢就生长出来了。
Realizing how important vegetation was.Villagers abandoned their traditional practice of continuously cultivating sloping fields, which had been passed down for thousands of years by their ancestors, and instead returned the precious and scarce farmland to forests and grasslands. In recent years, 4 square kilometers of land in the whole village have been divided into a ratio of 3 parts forest land, 2 parts grassland,and 1 part arable land with an emphasis on both ecological and economic efficiency.
整个这个阳山多的多天，苹果树，那么它北边山整个生态的，25坡土以上的修地铁，25以下种草种树，沟里有地大把爷，逐步的这个实行的做下这里，一个目的就是叫黄土不能吃漏的，就是逐步的变成绿色。
Currently, Gaoxigo has a forest and grass coverage rate of 70% and a soil erosion control rate of 78%.
看看，环境好了，鸟儿都回来了，各种鸟。林子里面形成自己的生态系统了，是自然形成的。
喂两把药，喂些少了。
这是喂不是料的，
不是饲料，这好像都草料。
草料，
这是草跟玉米几样粉。
这个是从店边买的草粉。
玉米干。
当地的玉米干。
这是两份儿、三份儿的，一份儿的，对起。
不干草，
不放。
逐步都要消灭这个散放养这个制度，农民也接受了，生态给我带来好处了，所以农民他就不愿意放养。羊的肥料还得着这个营养素质，氮磷兼得，果树最适合养分。肥料然后经过白起发酵以后，就直接上了果树了。
Nowadays, apple cultivation has become a key industry, bringing prosperity in Gaoxigo.
We make apples, one apple, one tree, 好的，收入1000多。它既有生态效应，又有经济效应。对我们来说，这都是农民致富的金蛋蛋。
你是给我们老婆老汉两个光干过呀？我们挣的2万几3万。
With continuous exploration that spans over 70 long years across 3 generations, villagers in Gaoxigo have not only effectively controlled soil erosion, but have also discovered a path to symbiotic development, harmonizing ecology and economic benefits.
进入九月份以后了，我们山上的苹果啊着就的都会成熟，欢迎大家啊都来到我们高西沟呢参观苹果园啊，苹果采摘。哦，
看见了吗？
从2007年以后，我们的生态就不好了，自然生长也有。过去的是没有一棵自然生，起来就养起来，现在有10%的这个自然能够飞的来着。未来我们高西沟在现有的这个林位，我们继续要保护，它生态会越来越好。
Reclamation of arable land from China's Loess Plateau exemplifies the country's national commitment to food security through self-sufficiency via expanding domestic agriculture. But there are risks and challenges. First, the long-standing tight balance between food supply and demand, which will become increasingly acute as living standards continue to rise. Second, resource and environmental constraints also continue to rise, as per capita arable land and per capita water resources are far below the world average. Third, scientific and technological innovation in agriculture, such as machinery, lag world-class levels. Fourth, low comparative efficiency and rising costs undermine farmers' enthusiasm for growing grain. And it is difficult to generate critical mass in grain production through large-scale operations. Moreover, even with a new government policy that offers subsidized land reclaimed from manufacturing sites to farmers, there is the worry that some of the land may have become unsuitable for agriculture. And many farmers, especially young people, have already migrated to large cities where they earn more money with less risk. The Chinese government is well aware of these challenges and remains determined to make agricultural reclamation work via multiple mechanisms. For example, by issuing financial subsidies to farmers from a set-aside of 10 billion yuan, or around $1.38 billion, to boost their incentives and facilitate the 2023 spring planting. President Xi provides the overview of China's agricultural modernization and food security mission. Through hard work, our country has provided for nearly one-fifth of the world's population, with 9% of the world's arable land and 6% of fresh water resources. Today, more than 1.4 billion people are eating well. About a decade ago, a rural expert told me, historically, few countries, by the time they have reached the middle phase of industrialization, would still be plagued by agricultural issues. The fact that China is still dealing with agriculture is a sign that the countryside farmer situation has never been handled properly. But he stressed, it's not for lack of government concern. It was in 2017 that CPC General Secretary Xi Jinping gave the directive to implement the strategy of rural vitalization. He said it would have fundamental impact on the nation. The party's target date for rural vitalization is 2035. Thriving businesses, pleasant living environments, social etiquette and civility, effective governance, and prosperity. Without the vitalization of the countryside, there can be no social stability, no common prosperity, no national rejuvenation. Having spent his early career as a local official in rural areas, Xi Jinping is determined to advance agricultural modernization and rural reforms. He stresses food security, both for supporting citizens' economic and social development, and for ensuring national development and national security, all of which modernizes the country and comprehensively promotes the great rejuvenation of the Chinese nation. That's closer to China.